In this video we will discuss coordinate change and how the Lagrangian changes under the coordinate change. Specifically, we will also discuss an example where we will observe a free particle in a rotating frame, and we will see the implications that we will get the pseudo forces, the Coriolis force and the centrifugal force. So these are the coordinates x1 to xn, and then we make a transformation to a different set of coordinates q1 to qn, and such that these coordinates, each of the coordinate qi, it is a function of these coordinates 1 to n, and it can depend also on time. Now with this we can write the Jacobian matrix ij by derivating del xi over del x qj, and if this Jacobian, if this is non-zero, then we know that the inverse transformation for each of the coordinate can be performed. So we here assume that the coordinate transformation and the inverse transformation both will exist. In other words, each of these xi's, which was the initial coordinate, can be written as a function of qi's and time, and the qi's also can be written as a function of xi's and time. So with these two we can calculate the qi dots and the xk dots, which are conjugate to these coordinates xi and qi. So it will just be the derivatives. So here this is dqi dt, so we can use the chain rule, and then it will be as qi is a function of n variables, there will be a summation. So it is del qi over del xj, xj dot. And here there is a summation over this j from 1 to n. All the repeated index in this video will be summed over. And plus we have this. So we can check that there is a single free index. And here also there is a single free index, a single free index. Similar calculation can be done here. And we can also check that the free index is k throughout. So with these two, we will now see that given a Lagrangian, that is depending on this two xi's and these x dots, which are, they are independent of each other, and these are the configuration space variables or the configuration space coordinates, and here we will try to evaluate the relation between the new coordinates del l over del qj and their derivatives with respect to time. So del l over del qj can be again written using the chain rule. So we write it as a partial derivative once with respect to this and the second time with respect to this. So this is the first one and this is the second one. Here again a quick check shows that the j is the free index, and there is a summation here, there is a summation here, and there is the j. So further, even this summation index can be also different, but let's keep it same for the time being. It doesn't harm to keep it same. So then we can write this x dot that we have here, this x dot, and we can put x dot here from this particular form. So that I have put here the x dot. This is just this entire thing. And once we have done that, we have almost evaluated this del L over del qj. The last step will be to push this derivative inside, and we will see we will get a double derivative in xk. In both the places, in here and here. So now we will evaluate del L over del qj dot. This is again simple to perform. We will just use the chain rule. So we do the derivative with respect to xk as well as xk dot, and we sum them over. But now you see this particular part here, xk that we have is a function of only the qi's, not the qi dots or the conjugate part. So here we will get this part as zero, and only thing that will remain is this particular thing. So here let's see, so we are derivatizing with respect to q dot, and here we will first do the derivative with respect to x and then with respect to q dot. But here you see, here actually there should be a dot here also and here also, because I am doing the derivative with respect to q dot, but as there will be a dot in the numerator and denominator, they will cancel. So this is the final term that I will get from here. So now this term, we must remember that here this derivative over xk with respect to qj, this entire thing will actually again will be a function of these coordinates q1 to n and t, because simply because this x was a function because of the invertibility, this x was a function of these coordinates and t. So the derivative, if we perform once the derivative with respect to one of the q, we will still get a function with respect to q and t. So with this much understanding, we will now calculate the time derivative of this particular quantity that we just now calculated, and that is again done by the chain rule. So we will do the time derivative of this, and in the second one, time derivative of this that I have written here. And then in the second part, when I do the time derivative of this particular part, what I will do is time derivative of this part with respect to so time derivative of this entire quantity that I am showing in the bracket will be partial derivative with respect to these qi's, and then time derivative of the qi's plus the partial derivative with respect to t. So that I have written here. So you see, we are getting two derivatives, second derivatives with respect to this xk. And further, we can calculate, do a quick calculation of the free index. So only j must be the free index. You see here also k is summed over 1 to n. And here also I have a sum over k as well as sum over this I. This I summation is coming from simply using this derivative and the chain rule. So with this understanding, now it is quite easy to calculate the entire quantity, because this thing that we have in the bracket, this second derivative, is simply this entire function. So this thing that we have in the square bracket is this entire thing that we have here in the square bracket. And along with this particular part here, this entire part can directly be put here. So what we will get is derivative of this will be of this form. This. Now everything is very simple now. We can rearrange them and we will get this relation. So what this relation is telling us is that if the Euler-Lagrange equations, they were in the old coordinates, they were holding. This is the form of the Euler-Lagrange equation in the old coordinates. They still hold in the new coordinates. So unlike the Newton's law, which changes on changing the coordinates, we see that the Euler-Lagrange, the form of Euler-Lagrange equation, the equation of motion will be different. But the form of the Lagrangian equation, this Euler-Lagrange equation, it remains same. And here also you see this Jacobian appearing here. So as it is non-zero, we are assured that if this is zero, then this is zero, because this is anyway non-zero. So with this, we do a quick analysis of this rotating frame concept. So you see, suppose our frame is rotating with this omega, which is a constant velocity, so it is uniform rotation. And here we see, if we have x and y axis initially, they will rotate into each other and we will get x prime, y prime. So x prime can be written as a part coming from x cos omega t and a part coming from y sin omega t. And y prime can be written as a part coming from y, this is y cos omega t, and a part coming from x, but this is a negative direction, that is x sin omega t. So this is the minus. So with this understanding of xyz coordinates, we can write our initial free particle Lagrangian, that is half m x dot square, y dot square, z dot square, which is only the kinetic energy term. It can be written in this form, completely re-expressed in terms of the primed coordinates or the new coordinates. So this form can easily be checked. You can do the x dot derivative by doing the derivative with respect to x once and then cos omega t, and then subtract from it omega y prime, and then you will get this particular combination of term. This part also will give this combination of term, and when you do the square, we will see that we exactly get this term here. So this is the valid form of Lagrangian, and we will use this Lagrangian now. So let us see. So here we will use it. So this is the Lagrangian that we discussed, written in the new coordinates. This is simply the free particle Lagrangian expressed in the new coordinates. But now we know the Euler-Lagrange equation holds. So we will just calculate those equations. That is, in the new coordinates, we will calculate d dt del L over del x prime dot equal to del L over del x for x and y and z. So for this, we calculate del L over del x prime, del L over del y prime and del L over del z prime. It is again quite easy to do this derivative. It will just come from this second term that I am showing here. And once we do that, we can also further do the derivative with respect to this del L over del x dot and doing the time derivative. So over and all, we will finally get three equations. First of all, there is z double dot will be 0. So because you see del L over del z prime is 0. And so z double dot is 0. And anyway, the motion was along the fixed axis. So z axis was fixed, as we remember. And so, and also in the free particle case, there was no force acting along z. So the acceleration along z will be 0 or velocity constant. But the in the primed coordinate system, in the primed coordinate system, we are seeing that we are getting some forces. So, in general, if the coordinate system was unprimed, we will get m r double dot equal to 0, where r can be x, y, z. But here we see there is acceleration present, and there are two different origins. One is a term proportional to omega, and the derivative of this primed coordinate, that is a velocity, and another proportional to omega square. So now it doesn't take much to identify that these terms are just Coriolis and these forces. Particularly if I want to write this entire equation in vector form, I will get omega cross r contribution and a contribution of omega cross r dot, r prime dot, all r prime. So we will get these two contributions, omega 2 omega cross r contribution and omega cross r prime contribution. And using this and taking care of this sign here, these signs here, we will finally get mr double dot in the primed coordinate, the acceleration in the primed coordinate, as a sum of two different forces. One of the forces is called Coriolis force and another one called centrifugal force. This is m omega square r prime and this is 2m omega r dot prime. So, so what is this force is now quite easy to understand. The notion was, when you were watching a particle from an inertial frame, suppose you were at rest and you were watching a particle going in a straight line with constant velocity, then you will say that the particle is a free particle. But now suppose you are watching that particle from a frame that is rotating, then you will not see the particle path as free. So because you see, the moment you change the coordinate system, you will see these forces are winding the path of the particle. So in a frame that is rotating, the particle will appear to rotate and not travel in a straight line. You can always grow to a frame which is non-rotating or which is stationary at rest, then you will see again the particle in straight line. So these forces are just the consequence of the frame that we are picking up. Now, we, depending on notations, we may call them fictitious forces or not, but they are definitely present there. One of the nice examples of this Coriolis force and the centrifugal force, it is simply the Foucault pendulum, which was a idea that you see a pendulum, when you make it oscillate, it oscillates about in this particular fashion. So it goes there and comes back. But this is when you are looking at it from a stationary frame of reference. But if we go to a frame that is rotating, like the earth is rotating, so ideally if we hang a pendulum inside anywhere inside earth, ideally we must see that the pendulum cannot perform a motion in a in this particular in a plane in a constant fixed plane. So even if you start the motion in a fixed plane, the pendulum will start rotating because of these forces, because simply Earth is a rotating frame. And this is indeed true. The change of the frame of this pendulum observed by us is so small that these require extreme precision to find these to actually track these small rotations, but they are definitely there in the Foucault pendulums that are in various museums and in places. So that's all for this video. In this video we discussed this coordinate change and the Lagrangian, how it affects it. It keeps the equation of motion unchanged. So that's